Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us for the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame induction ceremony, honoring our nation's space heroes. Please rise for the presentation of colors by the Embry-Riddle Naval ROTC Color Guard and the national anthem sung by Miss Beth Perdue.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome today's Master of Ceremonies, former CNN space correspondent and award-winning journalist, Mr. John Zarella.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Embry-Riddle Naval ROTC Color Guard, and Ms. Perdue. It is a privilege to serve as your Master of Ceremonies for the 2021 United States Astronaut Hall of Fame induction. Yes, you heard me correctly. Although we are just a few weeks away from the start of year 2022, we are here today to celebrate the Hall of Fame induction for the class of 2020. Our three inductees were selected in 2020, however, their induction ceremony has been postponed until now to allow us to safely honor their achievement with their friends and families. Thankfully, patience and perseverance are prerequisites for an astronaut career, and these three spaceflight veterans, all of whom have spent significant time living aboard the International Space Station, were undoubtedly better prepared to handle the pandemic than any of us. They're no strangers to isolation, cramped quarters, wearing protective face masks. If you think putting on a mask is cumbersome, imagine how it feels to put on an EVA suit and helmet every time you want to go outside. After the last 2 years we've all had, it is even more meaningful to be with you in person for the very special and time-honored event. May we never again take for granted the opportunity to gather together in celebration as we are today. This is indeed a long-awaited and joyous occasion as we prepare to honor three distinguished space explorers who have each enjoyed a record-breaking astronaut career and have made incredibly significant contributions to NASA and the world. Because the ceremony has fallen so late in the year, there will not be a 2021 class of inductees. But I think when you hear the accomplishments of these three astronauts, you'll agree that they are more than qualified to represent both years. Today, at long last, we induct three astronaut heroes into the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame: Michael López-Alegría, Pam Melroy, and Scott Kelly. Together, they comprised the 19th class of space shuttle astronauts to be inducted in the Hall of Fame, bringing the total count of astronauts in this prestigious society to 101. Before we move on, I'd like to recognize the many distinguished guests who have joined us today. Bill Nelson, NASA Administrator. Hortense Blackwell, Director of Communications and Public Engagement, NASA's John F. Kennedy Space Center. Michael Griffin, former NASA Administrator. Her Excellency Maggie Macario Doyle, Ambassador of the Principality of Monaco to the United States and Canada. Among our distinguished guests are, of course, a number of astronauts. Please welcome, in flight order, John David Bartow, Bernard Harris, Wendy Lawrence, Katie Coleman, Susan Kilrain, David Williams, and Sandy Magnus. Also here to celebrate the outstanding accomplishments of our inductees are a few of their predecessors, other fearless explorers who have deepened our understanding of space through their brave endeavors and have since taken their place in the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame. I'd like to recognize them in flight order now. They will pause for a moment in front of the stage before taking their seats. Logging more than 500 hours in space on three missions, this pilot and commander also led the Space Shuttle Orbiter return to flight team following the Challenger tragedy. Brewster Shaw. An accomplished fighter pilot who dedicated 25 years to military service. He orbited Earth 319 times as a mission specialist on STS-51C, 61A, STS-29, and STS-48, flying with a still classified military payload, conducting science research and deploying NASA satellites. Jim Buckley. He became the first astronaut to log 1,000 hours aboard the space shuttle during his fifth and final flight, STS-75. This scientist has served NASA as a mission specialist, payload commander, and spacewalker. Jeff Hoffman. He is a veteran of three space shuttle missions, logging more than 455 hours in space. He served as pilot on STS-51B, Space Lab 3, and was the space commander on STS-33 and 44. Fred Gregory. He is a veteran of four space shuttle flights, two as pilot, two as commander, including STS-60, the historic first joint American-Russian shuttle mission. He retired in 2017 after 6.5 years as NASA administrator. Charlie Bolden. This six-time space shuttle flyer served as pilot on his first flight, STS-32, and went on to command his next five missions. He has logged nearly 1,600 hours in space. James Weatherby. He is a veteran of four space flights, serving as pilot for two and commander for two, ultimately logging 38 days in space. He is the former center director here at NASA's Kennedy Space Center and was named associate administrator for NASA in May of this year. Robert Cabana. He was the second American commander of the International Space Station and completed the first night landing of the space shuttle at Kennedy Space Center. He was the commander of the ISS during the attacks on 9/11, Frank Culbertson. A two-time pilot, two-time commander, and a spacewalker, this veteran of four space shuttle missions spent a total of 40 days in space and played a key role in the assembly of the ISS. Brian Duffy. He is a veteran of six space flights, during which he logged more than 1,380 hours, or 57 days in space. He also served as commander of STS-95, John Glenn's historic return to space. Kurt Brown. She is a veteran of five shuttle missions. As a crew member of the ISS's Expedition 2, she lived aboard the station for 163 days and set a world record for her nearly 9-hour spacewalk. Susan Elms. She is a veteran of five shuttle missions as a crew member of the ISS's Expedition 2. Oh, I just did that. Susan, I'm giving you the introduction twice. That's how good it was and how good you are. She is a veteran of four space flights, logging more than 35 days in space. She first made history in 1995 when she took the controls of Discovery on STS-63 to become the first woman space shuttle pilot. She again made history as commander of Columbia on STS-93, Eileen Collins. This five-flight veteran has logged more than 58 days in space. He conducted eight spacewalks totaling 58 hours and 30 minutes on three different missions to repair the Hubble Space Telescope. John Grunsfeld. He is a five-time space shuttle astronaut who has logged more than 1,600 hours in space. He flew as mission commander on two, including STS-96, the first ever docking of a shuttle to the International Space Station. Kent Rominger. Kent? He commanded the second return-to-flight mission after the Columbia tragedy and the final flight of the space shuttle Discovery. He logged 62 days, 22 hours, and 33 minutes. We don't have the seconds here. In space to serve as, and you served as chief of the astronaut office. Steve Lindsay. He served in various roles at the Johnson Space Center and NASA headquarters, piloting two space shuttle missions and commanding two more, including STS-125, the fifth and final servicing mission for the Hubble Space Telescope. In total, he spent more than 51 days in space, but his greatest accomplishment may be that he is the two-time champion of the Astronaut Cocktail Challenge. The reigning champion, Scott Altman. We bow to your excellence, sir. On her three space flights, she has served as a mission specialist, flight engineer, and prime robotics operator, performing spacewalks crucial to the assembly of the ISS. She helped lead return-to-flight efforts and oversaw the final flights of the space shuttle. Janet Cavandi. Thank you to all of the distinguished astronauts who have taken the time to join us today. Let's have one more round of applause for our United States Astronaut Hall of Fame astronauts. That's a lot of words. And we have more. Before we move on with our ceremony, I would like to take a moment to pay tribute to the astronauts who have passed away since our last induction. Skylab and Shuttle astronaut Owen Garriott passed away in April 2019 at the age of 88. Garriott was a rare breed of both pilot and scientist, earning his PhD in teaching engineering at Stanford before earning qualifications as a pilot in jet aircraft from the United States Navy. On his first flight, Skylab 3, he set a world record for duration with a 60-day mission. He flew again on STS-9 Space Lab 1, spending another 10 days in space. Godspeed, Owen Garriott. Apollo astronaut Al Warden passed away in March of 2020 at the age of 88. As the command module pilot for Apollo 15, he orbited the moon alone, more than 2,000 miles away from another human being. During his only mission, he logged a 38-minute spacewalk outside Endeavour command module, completing his the first ever deep space EVA. He went on to serve as chair of the board of directors for the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation from 2005 to 2011. Rest in peace, Al Warden. Gerald Jerry Carr completed his mission here on Earth in August of 2020, also at age 88. As commander of the Skylab 4 mission, Carr and his crew conducted a remarkable science program that included a wealth of biomedical investigations designed to test the effects of long-duration spaceflight on the human body, as well as solar observations that revolutionized our understanding of the sun. He then turned his attention to the space shuttle program and the consideration of human factors that were pivotal in shaping NASA's long-term space missions. Farewell, Jerry Carr. Physician astronaut William Thornton was selected as an astronaut in 1967 and launched twice on the Space Shuttle Challenger on STS-8 and STS-51B, the Space Lab 3 mission. He logged 313 hours in space. Thornton had a significant influence in the evolution of space life sciences and worked closely with NASA's biomedical laboratory teams. He retired from NASA in 1994. William Thornton passed away at the age of 91. Thank you, William Thornton. Apollo-era astronaut Philip K. Chapman was the first Australian-born American astronaut. He was selected in August 1967 to be a member of Astronaut Group 6, who were primarily scientists rather than pilots. After his selection to the Astronaut Corps, he completed 1 year of training at Randolph Air Force Base, Texas, and he was involved in preparations for lunar missions, serving in particular as mission scientist for the Apollo 14 mission. Dr. Chapman left the agency in 1972. He passed away on April 5th, 2021, at the age of 86. Farewell, Philip Chapman. The world lost another great man in April of this year, Gemini and Apollo astronaut Michael Collins. Collins first flew on Gemini 10, conducted two EVAs, then went on to serve as the command module pilot for Apollo 11. As Armstrong and Aldrin made their historic moonwalks, he then served as director of the National Air and Space Museum and undersecretary of the Smithsonian before embarking on a career in the private sector. Along with his Apollo 11 crewmates, Collins was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom in 1969 and the Congressional Gold Medal in 2011. He passed away at the age of 90. We salute you, Michael Collins. Each of these extraordinarily brave men made remarkable contributions to the exploration of space, and their legacies will live on. Please observe a moment of silence in their honor. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, here to say a few words on behalf of the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex is Chief, you're the chief, aren't you? The Chief Operating Officer, Mr. Theron Protzy. Theron?
Thanks, John. I just like going by designated fall guy. Good morning, and welcome to Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex. Thank you for joining us today, and so great to see everybody in person. It is our honor to host today's ceremony to welcome NASA astronauts Michael López-Alegría, Pam Melroy, and Scott Kelly. We are all thankful to continue to safely offer the guests the opportunity to learn and be inspired by the story of NASA and space exploration. It is also a very exciting time here at the Visitor Complex. We've continued to enhance exhibits and add new attractions. Planet Play, if you haven't experienced it yet, is a whole new, fully immersive, multiple-story play experience designed for all the little generation that's going to be taking us to Mars. Ages 2 and 12, but I've seen as people as old as 80 go down those slides. Children will enjoy learning the fun facts, because that's what it takes to them to be immersive, but then also learn at the same time. They have one-of-a-kind digital and play activities to create memorable learning experiences, including opportunities to map a constellation, slide down a wormhole, walk on Saturn's rings, and slide through an asteroid field. And don't worry, parents, we didn't forget you either. On the second level, there is a little wine, coffee, and beer, and probably a little bit of water area for you to sit, relax, recharge, and also play some serious trivia games to learn about space while your explorers play. The Rocket Garden also gained a new addition of a United Launch Alliance Delta II rocket. The Delta II program came to a close with the final launch in 2018. But its legacy will continue to inspire with historic rockets that are also in the Rocket Garden. We added a life-size Perseverance and Ingenuity in Journey to Mars. And we upgraded our new bus fleet. You probably see them. They're all decked out, and they're all space-themed, talking about our next great mission of Artemis, as well as other huge screens and other experiences to enjoy while you tour the Kennedy Space Center. Our Apollo 7 5 now includes life-size holograms of some of the Apollo heroes, where you can ask them questions, and they get to tell their own story in their words. And it's just truly amazing. We just mentioned Al Warden, a dear friend, who just passed, and we were able to capture him right before that, and I get to see him every day. So I always ask him all the questions. I never knew he was in Mr. Rogers' TV show. So if you ever get a chance, he's got some great stories he tells there. There are so many innovations that are coming on the horizon. You may have noticed a big, beautiful, green, purple, whatever which way the sun catches it building right through the Rocket Garden. That will open in spring of 2022. The Deep Space Launch Complex called Gateway. The multi-level attraction will familiarize guests with NASA's missions of today, the future of space exploration, interplanetary travel, and one-of-a-kind experiences, exhibits, entertainment, and education. On the second level, all I'm going to tell you, there is an immersive experience that's going to take you through space journeys, and you learn about why space exploration is so important. We look forward to opening the new attraction and to inspiring our guests about the future of space exploration, because it is so exciting. Now I'd like to welcome Kurt Brown, the chair of the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation, to say a few words. Kurt?
Well, those are tough acts to follow, but good morning, everyone, and thank you all for being here with us today. As chairman of the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation, it gives me great pride to see so many fellow astronauts, guests, and friends of guests here to celebrate in person. We were gone for 2 years, we're now back, but here we're here in person to induct Michael López-Alegría, Pam Melroy, and Scott Kelly into the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame. Already using the Mercury Seven's joint credibility to encourage students to pursue scientific endeavors through the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation, they decided there should be a permanent place to celebrate the accomplishments of America's space pioneers and to share the human side of spaceflight in a unique and personal way. So their dream, the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame, became a reality in 1990. And 5 years ago, the Visitor Complex opened the Heroes and Legends featuring the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame presented by Boeing. Thanks to the partnership with Delaware North and the support of the companies and individual supporters, The Astronaut Scholarship Foundation awards a merit-based scholarship to more than 60 of the best and brightest STEM students annually. This prestigious astronaut scholarship is known nationwide for being among the highest monetary scholarships awarded to the undergraduate STEM students. Since its inception, ASF has awarded more than $7 million in scholarships to almost 700 of the nation's top students. We are very proud of our scholars and their accomplishments. And in fact, we have a group of astronaut scholarship recipients with us here today. Would you please give them a round of applause? And if they want to stand up, please stand. Thank you, scholars. They know why they come to these things, because they know they're going to have a good time. So thanks for showing up for us. We appreciate the support we receive from all the astronauts, our friends at NASA, as well as Theron Proxy and everyone at the Kennedy Space Center complex. We couldn't do it without all of you, obviously. Their support is truly appreciated. It is now my pleasure to welcome Michael López-Alegría, Pam Melroy, Scott Kelly into the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame. Once again, thank you all for your support and for being here with us today to share in this amazing celebration. Now, it is my honor to introduce NASA Administrator, Mr. Bill Nelson, to the stage.
John Zarilla, thank you for serving as Master of Ceremonies, and more importantly, thank you for covering the space program like you've done over the years, all these decades. There are sites that symbolize the daring spirit of the American character, and the Kennedy Space Center is one of those places. It's a place where unthinkable missions are accomplished by remarkable people. Explorers, pioneers, and adventurers have graced these grounds for nearly 60 years. It's a fitting home for the Astronaut Hall of Fame. Astronauts cement America's reputation as a beacon of discovery. And today, we gather to honor three legendary astronauts, Mike López-Alegría, Pam Melroy, and Scott Kelly. And from this sacred site, these three pioneers propelled upward. They explored the heavens, they broke barriers, and they set records. They pushed the boundaries of humanity's reach. And today we are including a trailblazer who wanted to play with planes, not dolls. As a young girl, she was fascinated by the sky. She dreamed of flying among the clouds. Well, she did, and she did more. Pam Melroy served as the pilot on two missions and the commander on another. And if I might add, NASA is blessed to have a visionary leader like the deputy administrator. And before this, of course, she was the second woman in the Air Force to be a test pilot. Today, we are also inducting an adventurer who raised in New Jersey. His parents were police officers. They pushed him to serve his community as an emergency medical technician during high school. They encouraged him and his twin brother to pursue lofty, lofty goals. Scott Kelly did just that. He inspired the world when he spent many, many days aboard the ISS. And we know Scott is proud that he and his brother, Senator Mark Kelly, were the first twin siblings to become astronauts in NASA's history. And I might say that twin brother taught us a lot, Mark Kelly, about how to be a husband in the way that he operated and took care of his wife after that terrible tragedy. And finally, today, we're inducting an explorer who immigrated from Spain when he was a young boy. Mike López-Alegría would go on to perform 10 spacewalks. He holds the longest all-time EVA duration record among NASA astronauts, and he's not done yet. He will return to low Earth orbit, this time as commander of the Axiom Private Astronaut Mission 1 to the ISS. And there he has a real job because he's going to be the caretaker of some private astronauts. Well, we honor these three astronauts today for their extraordinary achievements in space, but let's also learn from their aspirations. Each of these individuals has a unique story. Each has ventured into the cosmos as a NASA astronaut. This agency has the ability to bring people together. It's one of the few in the federal government. And this agency has the opportunity to benefit humanity. We unify, we discover, we inspire, not only with the human spaceflight program, but all the science that we do in the aeronautical research. Next month, we're going to launch a telescope and position it 1 million miles from the Earth, on the opposite side of the Earth from the sun. It's going to peer out. It's going to peer through a keyhole in the sky. And it's going to look back and capture light from over 13 billion years ago. Light that was emitted only 250 million years after the Big Bang. The light that is the formation of the first galaxy. These are just some of the things that this little agency is doing in addition to the human space flight program. Americans and people from around the world will continue to come to this museum. Many of them will be children, and they are members of the new generation, the Artemis generation. And as they learn about the legacies of these astronauts, they too will be inspired. Perhaps they one day will join a NASA family as a technician or as an engineer, a mathematician, a scientist, maybe an astronaut. It's all a team. Maybe they'll walk on the moon, or maybe they'll take humanity's next giant leap and venture to Mars. There are limitless possibilities because of the endless inspiration found among these giants and in this museum. And so to Michael, to Pam, to Scott, congratulations on this well-earned recognition, and thank you for daring us to keep looking upward and pushing outward into the unknown. Thank you, and God bless you.
when I saw Administrator Nelson earlier before the event started, I hadn't seen him in quite some time, and I hadn't congratulated him on becoming Administrator Nelson. We go back, we were talking probably 40 years, from the early days, the early 80s, I guess it is. I'm dating myself, and I'm dating you. I'm sorry. But when I looked at him, I said, so do I call you Administrator Nelson? Do I call you Senator Nelson? And he said, no, it's just Bill. And that's kind of the relationship that we had over the years. He's a good man, and I've enjoyed our many years of friendship. Now I'd like to introduce the Director of Communications and Public Engagement at NASA's John F. Kennedy Space Center, Hortense Blackwell.
Good morning. It is an honor to be here as we celebrate the incredible achievements of the three individuals that we will be recognizing today. We often say here at the Kennedy Space Center that we launch the nation's dreams, but it is the dedication of men and women like Michael, Pam, and Scott who carry these dreams and lead us to a path forward for exploration. Earlier this week, we launched a crew to the International Space Station. And on that vehicle was the 599th, the 600th, and the 601st humans to fly in space. Now, that may sound like a large number, but when we think back over the past 60 years of spaceflight and contemplate on the enormous strides we have made in science, technology, and exploration, we realize that the 601 people who have went to space is a small number indeed for the mighty achievements that we've made. The crew, the honorees. The honorees have showed their bravery, their perseverance, their integrity, their teamwork, and their determination to extend and do well in their exploration for flight. They have done remarkable things that we are at. And we honor them today. They, along with their fellow astronauts, have paved the way for the next 60 years for space exploration and beyond. We here at the Kennedy Space Center are very proud of all of their accomplishments. Michael, Pam, and Scott, on behalf of Janet Petro, the Center Director here at the Kennedy Space Center, and the entire KSC workforce. Congratulations and thank you for your contributions to our country and to our planet. Thank you.
Theron Protzi, who was up here, he just presented me with my annual pass to the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex. So it's greatly appreciated, my friend. You know that. You all get them. Yes, you all get them. Is this annual or is it lifetime? I don't have that many years left. You could have given me a lifetime one. Thank you all. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now time to begin the induction of the 19th class of Space Shuttle astronauts into the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame. The 2020 inductees were selected by a committee of current Hall of Fame astronauts, former NASA officials, historians, and journalists. The process is administered by the Astronaut Selection Foundation. To be eligible, an astronaut must have made his or her first flight at least 17 years before the induction year and must be retired at least 5 years from the NASA Astronaut Corps. Candidates must be a U.S. citizen, a NASA-trained commander, pilot, or mission specialist, must have orbited the Earth at least once, and made significant contributions to the study of space. Our first inductee is Michael López-Alegría. Michael López-Alegría has more than 35 years of aviation and space experience with the U.S. Navy and NASA in a variety of roles, including naval aviator, engineering test pilot, and program manager and NASA astronaut.
At this time, Michael López-Alegría is preparing to board the vehicle. He will serve as the flight engineer on this mission. Go for main engine start. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and liftoff. Liftoff of the Space Shuttle Columbia, catapulting scientific knowledge and microgravity research.
Here we have Michael López-Alegría, mission specialist number 4. He will join Jeff Wyzoff on EVAs 2 and 4. They will install and hook up PMA 3 to the Unity module of the International Space Station.
LA, or me putting on electrodes on LA's brain to see if there's anything going on in there. No, just kidding.
As you saw there, LA is a veteran of 4 space flights. During his first mission, STS-73 in 1995, he served as a mission specialist on this science-driven 16-day mission. Following that flight, he spent several years leading NASA's ISS Crew Operations Office. He returned to space in 2000 as a mission specialist on STS-92, During this mission, he and crewmate Jeff Weisshoff tested the Safer Jet backpack, flying 50 feet from the safety of the spacecraft to test the effectiveness of this emergency propulsion backpack system. This inductee is not only an astronaut, he is also an aquanaut. In 2001, he served on NASA's Extreme Environment Mission Operations, or the NEMO team, living aboard the Aquarius Underwater Laboratory. He went back to space as the commander of ISS Expedition 14, flying to and from the ISS aboard a Soyuz TMA-9. He holds NASA records for the most extravehicular activities, 10, and cumulative EVA time, 67 hours and 40 minutes. Overall, he is the second most experienced spacewalker in the world. When he landed in 2007, he held the record for longest mission of any American, 2,015 days. López-Alegría is the former president of the Commercial Spaceflight Foundation, where he was a spokesman, thought leader, and advocate with the U.S. Congress and pertinent executive agencies for favorable public policy on behalf of the commercial spaceflight industry. Currently, he is an independent consultant to traditional and commercial space companies and serves on several advisory boards and committees of public and private institutions, including the Human Exploration and Operations Committee of the NASA Advisory Council and the Commercial Space Transportation Advisory Committee to the FAA. And between that, he does sleep periodically. López-Alegría is the chairman of ASTM International's Committee on Commercial Spaceflight and past president of the Association of Space Explorers, an international, professional, and educational organization of current and former astronauts. Please welcome Michael López-Alegría. Here to present Michael López-Alegría for induction into the Hall of Fame, astronaut Brian Duffy. Brian.
Well, thank you, everybody. You know, Mike just said, "Be nice." So as I go forward here, telling the Mike LA story. You know, you're going to hear a few things that will make you realize that we don't compare scripts ahead of time, because a lot of the things that Administrator Bill Nelson said, and as well as John's introduction of LA, I have it included in my script as well, so you'll get a chance to hear it again. But Mike, it's such an honor to be asked to present you for induction. You know, thank you for doing that. You're a great friend, valued crewmate. Get a lot of shared experiences together. I'd also like to take, at this time, an opportunity to congratulate Pam, my pilot on STS-92, so obviously another good friend, as well as Scott Kelly. I have to tell you, I'm not surprised that any of them are here. The fact that what they've accomplished in their military and in their spaceflight careers is legendary, as has been mentioned. And so the fact that they are here being inducted is no surprise. Mike was born in Madrid, Spain, as was mentioned, and moved to the United States as a young boy. He really admired his father a lot, and I knew that from our experiences together, how much he valued your dad. Mike's dad, despite the fact that he didn't know a lot of English, moved the family to the United States, and he found a work as an electrician. But to improve the family situation, his father went to night school while he was working full time, and he became an electrical engineer. So So Michael's father had served in the Spanish Army Infantry, and Dad's military ways, I think, influenced Mike in very subtle ways. There was a day in July of 1969 when the world stopped and watched what was going on as the Columbia, or as the Apollo 11 Eagle lunar module descended to the surface of the moon. Mike, at the time, was playing on the beach as an 11-year-old with a lot of his friends, but he stopped then to see what was going on at the moon. Now, Mike didn't, he recognized the importance of such an event, but he never thought it'd be part of the space program. So, Mike had many talents growing up. I asked him, what do you like to do in school when you're growing up? And what I learned was that he was a star, no surprise. Proving his varied interests, he told me that he was part of a group called the Geeks and the Jocks. Yeah, not exactly a natural mix, but he was a student body vice president, a member of the math and the chess clubs. He was the captain of the soccer team, and he lettered in track and field as well. So, you know, Mike clearly demonstrated himself as a leader, not in one, but in many areas. So I asked him, how'd you end up at the Naval Academy? And he said he thinks he was the victim of a whisper campaign, a secret whisper campaign. Because magically, one day, a Naval Academy catalog appeared in the mailbox. Mike liked what he saw and started to pursue it. He received the nominations of both California senators as well as that of the Vice President of the United States. So just that is an amazing accomplishment for maybe an 18-year-old or so at the time. But he's, you could see how highly regarded all of his accomplishments were at that time by those nominations. While at the Academy, he chose systems engineering, a field that would enhance his Navy career. And upon graduation, he had a chance to have some options, career options, and he chose aviation. So he went to pilot training. He was designated as a naval aviator in 1981. Mike chose to fly propeller aircraft and found himself in Rota, Spain, in an assignment that he loved. It was a great squadron, a great mission, and an opportunity to explore the world. One day he saw a magazine that had a sidebar that listed the early astronauts, and he saw that they had gone through test pilot school. So he decided, well, if they can do it, so can I. So he applied to the test pilot school and was accepted. He was in a program where you went through the test pilot school and then you went through the Naval Postgraduate School. And at the end of that, then he graduated with a master's degree in aeronautical engineering. So I asked Mike, what did you enjoy most about test pilot school? Because I knew I loved it because I got a chance to fly 20 different airplanes in the course of a year. So it's a pilot's dream to be able to do that kind of thing. Mike said that that he liked flying jets there. So that's where he learned to fly jets. He said he felt like he was drinking from a fire hose, trying to catch up to everything else. But obviously, he mastered that like he has so many other things in his life. He was selected by NASA as an astronaut in 1992, and his incredible spaceflight career at that point began to take off. After the year of astronaut candidate training, he excelled in a number of mission support jobs, and then was assigned to the first mission that he flew, which was STS-73. And although he was a rookie on that flight, he was named Mission Specialist Number 2, which is a key position on the flight deck for launch and for landing. He was also the Blue Shift Commander for the round-the-clock science laboratory module. So I had the pleasure of flying with Mike on STS-92 in 2000, where his extravehicular activity skills really blossomed. He said one of the highlights on his second EVA, and it was mentioned by John, but it was the test flight of a self-rescue jetpack. And Mike flew from a point high on the International Space Station all the way down to the rear end of the shuttle's payload bay, demonstrating that an astronaut could rescue themselves should it be required by using this unit. He did three more EVAs on STS-113 to install the P-1 truss, among other things. But what has to be considered the highlight of his career was he was the commander of Expedition 14. As has been mentioned, he set the American record for a single mission at 215 days, during which he did five more spacewalks. So that brought his total to 10 EVAs, which was a record at the time, and over 67 hours outside an orbiting spacecraft. Unbelievable. It's pretty amazing. After leaving NASA, as was mentioned, Mike stayed involved in the space business in various capacities. And I thought Mike was done flying in space. I was wrong. He's scheduled to launch this February and make history again as the commander of Axiom Space's AX-1, the first private international space station mission. So it's no wonder that we're here today honoring one of human spaceflight's true stars, but his story continues, and we all wish him success. So before he leaves the planet again, it's my pleasure to present Captain Michael López-Alegría for induction into the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame.
Brian is the Messiah. If you don't know what this is, it's from a movie called Life of Brian. Turns out it was a different Brian, but the STS-92 crew went around calling him the Messiah all the time, which made him sign his emails NTM, not the Messiah. So, Madam Ambassador and Dr. Administrator Griffin, Administrator Bolden, and Representative Senator Administrator Bill. It goes without saying, but it's a huge honor and privilege to be inducted into this pantheon of American heroes. I really must give credit where it's most due, which is to my mother and father. She was born the seventh of eight children to a poor immigrant family in East Boston. And she was the youngest daughter, so she was charged with taking care of her infirm mother for many years. And finally, in her 30s, with a passion to see the world, she took the civil service exam and became a GS-1, or whatever the equivalent would be for an entry-level secretary. And see the world she did. She worked as a DoD civilian in Hawaii, Johnston Atoll, Tokyo, and then Madrid, where she met my father, who, as Brian mentioned, was a Spanish infantry officer. So back at the peak of Franco's regime, neither of their employers were too cool about this situation. In fact, they had to travel to Gibraltar to be wed on British soil, having to cross the Mediterranean four times to get there and back because the border was closed with Spain. And at some point, the heat got too hot, and I wasn't even two, and we emigrated to the US. And we rented a flat in the same building where my mother had been born and raised in East Boston. So as Brian mentioned, my father spoke no English, had no marketable skill in the US, and he went to trade school, became an electrician, went to night school, got a BS in electrical engineering, and then got hired in ever-increasing jobs of responsibility. And my Along the way, we moved to California, where I grew up as a happy middle-class kid, pretty unaware of our humble roots. And so while my parents were sort of living the American dream, I was having dreams of my own of becoming an astronaut. My next-door neighbor, best friend, and I played rocket ship in the closet of my bedroom, which was mocked up to look like some sort of space vehicle. And my mom, who was now working in an education office for NASA, brought home these things called, these brochures called NASA Facts. And I was pretty into it. And then the moment that Brian mentioned on the beach in Southern California in July of 1969 was transformational. So I got my lust for travel and adventure from my mom, and my dad imbued in me the fact that nothing is impossible. And it's in great part to them that I'm standing here. So since its first induction in 1990, the Astronaut Hall of Fame inductees have sort of mirrored the evolution of human spaceflight in America. The first group were all Mercury astronauts, the second were the Gemini flyers, the third included all of the Apollo plus Skylab folks. And with the fourth induction in 2001, we entered the shuttle era. And the next 18 classes consisted of astronauts who flew almost exclusively on the space shuttle. In fact, up to today, of all of the missions flown by the 98 previous inductees, only 18 were to the ISS. 13 of them were sortie missions on the space shuttle. Today, my fellow inductees and I, of the 11 flights that we've flown together, 8 of them were to the ISS. So we are entering the International Space Station era. And today, Scott and I are joining the first 4 American ISS commanders, Shep, Frank, Sox, and Mike Fole, as Hall of Fame inductees. 5 of 6 U.S. Navy, Kurt, just saying. The ISS is a singular achievement in human history, an incredibly complex engineering project made even more challenging by its international proprietorship of 5 agencies in 15 countries. Starting in 1998, hundreds of miles above the Earth at over 17,000 miles an hour, it was put together piece by piece. Many of these pieces had never even been in the same country, let alone the same room. And they were built by people speaking different languages, using different alphabets, and even different measuring systems. Today, it's a fully operational microgravity and space environment laboratory. It's been continuously inhabited for 21 years, and over 3,000 experiments have been conducted on board. But as magnificent as it is, the ISS is a machine, and one day it will wear out. And none of those 5 agencies or 15 countries have any serious indication of their intention to build a follow-on government platform. Yet many have indicated their desire to have their astronauts continue to go to low Earth orbit and do important human research, physical science investigations, and technology development and demonstration that can only be accomplished in a sustained microgravity environment. So what's the solution? A commercial space station, preferably more than one, with multiple customers where the government is only one of them. So in 2005, under Dr. Griffin and with Senator Nelson's support, NASA very wisely invested in commercial cargo and then later commercial crew transportation capabilities. Today, 2 companies, perhaps soon to be 3, are providing robust and reliable transportation of tons of supplies and experiment materiel to the ISS. Similarly, SpaceX has demonstrated safe, cost-effective, and reliable crew transportation to the orbital outpost, with Boeing to come online soon. These capabilities will no doubt outlast the ISS and will be ready to serve commercial destinations, but will those destinations be ready when the ISS is retired? No place better than the Space Coast knows the impact of a gap in human spaceflight capabilities. The 9-year hiatus of human launches from the Cape was devastating to the local economy. It's very gratifying to see that under Bob Cabana's leadership, the Kennedy Space Center has not only survived, but it is thriving. Although much smaller in scale, NASA's commercial LEO development program, including private astronaut missions, is an attempt to mirror its wise commercial cargo and crew investment in non-government service providers to avoid such a gap in microgravity platform availability. But commercial destinations must, by their very nature, be profitable. And in order to grow a viable economy in LEO, lines of business that NASA, appropriately as a government agency, has ignored must now be considered. While it is the role of governments to expand new frontiers and then step aside in favor of commercial and entrepreneurs, without a profit incentive, those merchants will stay home. And NASA can ill afford a gap in access to LEO platform. It must expand its horizons and allow private astronaut missions to plumb the gamut of revenue-generating opportunities, including advertisement, brand placement, and even entertainment. And while I know that's anathema to many of us, it is a critical step in building the demand that commercial platform providers need to close their business case. Else the enterprise will fail and access to low Earth orbit will end with it. To close, those of us being inducted today stand on the shoulders of those of you who have come before us. It is truly an honor, and we take very seriously our solemn duty to bear the weight of those who come after us. At some point in the not-too-distant future, the first Artemis-era astronaut will be standing on this stage delivering their remarks, and I am hopeful, that they will be sharing this stage with somebody who has spent time on a commercial LEO platform. Thank you.
Congratulations, LA. And now it's time to introduce our second candidate for induction into the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame, Pam Melroy.
Pilot, Pam Melroy. This will be her second space shuttle flight. 2, 1. We have booster ignition and liftoff of the space shuttle Atlantis, building the station and our future in space.
Flight deck of the shuttle Atlantis, Commander Jeff Ashby on the left, pilot Pam Melroy on the right as they prepare for the firing of the orbital maneuvering system engines. Thank you.
1, booster ignition and liftoff of Discovery, hoisting Harmony to the heavens and opening new gateways for international science. Discovery has cleared the tower.
Houston now controlling.
Discovery Commander Pam Melroy.
Great teamwork.
Phenomenal.
Excellent work, guys. Excellent.
Landing gear is down and locked in place.
It's great to be back in Florida, especially the home of Discovery. It's a thrilling day for both the space shuttle and the space station programs. And thank you to everybody for a beautiful vehicle and a beautiful mission.
Pam Melroy holds a bachelor's degree in physics and astronomy from Wellesley College and a master's degree in earth and planetary sciences from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. She was commissioned through the Air Force Reserve Officers Training Corps, ROTC, program in 1983. As a co-pilot, aircraft commander, instructor pilot, and test pilot, she logged more than 6,000 flight hours in more than 50 different aircraft before retiring from the Air Force in 2007 with the rank of colonel. She is a veteran of Operation Desert Shield, Desert Storm, and Operation Just Cause, with more than 200 combat and combat support hours. Melroy was selected as an astronaut candidate by NASA in December of 1994, initially assigned to astronaut support duties for launch and landing. She also worked advanced projects for the astronaut office and performed capsule communicator, CAPCOM, duties in mission control. In addition, she served on the Columbia reconstruction team as the lead for the crew module and served as deputy project manager for the Columbia crew survival investigation team. In her final position, she served as branch chief for the Orion branch of the astronaut office. One of only two women to command a space shuttle, Melroy logged more than 924 hours, or 38 days, in space. She served as pilot on two flights, STS-92 in 2000 and STS-112 in 2002, and was the mission commander on STS-120 in 2007. All three of her flights were assembly missions to build the International Space Station. After serving more than two decades in the Air Force and as a NASA astronaut, Melroy took on a number of leadership roles, including stints at Lockheed Martin, the Federal Aviation Administration, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, Nova Systems Australia, and as an advisor to the Australian Space Agency. She also served as an independent consultant and a member of the National Space Council's Users Advisory Group. Pam Melroy was sworn in as the NASA Deputy Administrator on June 21st of this year. Among her duties as Deputy Administrator, Melroy is responsible for laying the agency's vision and representing NASA to the Executive Office of the President, Congress, heads of federal and other appropriate government agencies, international organizations, and external organizations and communities. Please welcome Pam Melroy.
Going up to the spirit and sky.
To present Pam Melroy for induction is Hall of Fame astronaut Susan Helms.
Well, thank you, everybody, for being here for this august occasion. And I'd like to congratulate Pam and Mike L.A. and Scott for being so well-deserving to be inducted into today's Hall of Fame ceremony. Test pilot, astronaut, the Office of Commercial Space Transportation for the FAA, leader of the Tactical Technical Office of DARPA, Users Advisory Group for the National Space Council, and now Deputy Administrator of NASA. If there was one person who epitomizes the term giving back in support of our nation's space aspirations, it's Pam Melroy. Grown from humble circumstances and the daughter of a super supportive mother, Helen, and a wicked smart father, Dave, who has his own special history, by the way, in computer engineering, Pam had a laser focus on exactly who she was and what she wanted to be. At 8 years old, after seeing Neil and Buzz step on the moon, she just knew at that moment she wanted to be an astronaut. And never mind that at that time, the idea was completely unthinkable for a girl to want to do that. To the great credit of her parents, they did not tell her no, but yes, if that's what you want to be, you can do it. And this wasn't just a passing fancy, by the way. When Pam went to college at Wellesley in 1979 to get her bachelor's degree in physics and astronomy, she attended a meet and greet for new students. And from what I've heard, I think the conversation she had at that point went something like this. Hi. I'm Pam Melroy, and I'm going to be an astronaut. And I'm sure her fellow students probably thought, yeah, right. They may have underrated her drive, but now, years later, they surely have not forgotten that moment when their bright, ambitious classmate actually predicted the future. And for all of us, it, of course, reminds me of a phrase we often say that epitomizes Pam as a leader, which is, don't tell me no, just tell me how we get to yes. So Pam's path to astronaut and beyond is as much a story of her leadership journey as it is about her accomplishments. As a KC-10 aircraft commander being shot at during Desert Storm, it groomed her to lead with grace under fire, literally. She faced risky air refueling tests as a C-17 test pilot, but she always gave the right answer instead of the easy answer. I remember meeting Pam for the first time at PT's during the week of her astronaut interview, and it was like greeting an old friend because I had already heard so much about her through the Air Force Test Community Network. And through her astronaut career, she matured well beyond the stereotypical persona of a military leader. She absorbed the advice of astronaut mentors, such as Brian Duffy, and prioritized having a resilient team culture throughout pre-flight training, long before liftoff. Her crewmates told me that she was incredibly thoughtful, with high emotional intelligence. And as a leadership strategy, she really liked to build cohesive teams. So when you think of Pam's North Star as an aspect of her character, one thing came across from everyone I talked to. She really cares about the people that she leads. Many may remember Pam's third mission to the International Space Station, STS-20. You know, that was an iconic flight, because it was the first time that both a space shuttle commander, Pam, and the space station commander, Peggy Whitson, both happened to be female. And by the way, I do feel a little bit sorry for George Zamka, who was the shuttle pilot on that flight, because he got tagged with the role of having to take the iconic photograph of Peggy and Pam shaking hands through the hatch when the hatch opened between the two spacecraft. Talk about pressure. I'm sure that was, from what I've heard, the thing he felt the most pressure about through his whole flight was making sure he got that picture. But the flight is more well known among NASA folks as a mission that had a major equipment failure in the form of a torn solar panel. It was not a failure that could be minimized or ignored. Basically, if the panel couldn't get fixed in some way, shape, or form, for engineering reasons, it would have to be tossed overboard, leading to a cascade of issues for all following missions to the space station. And so the stakes were incredibly high. Mission control worked out a fix, but the twist to the story is that that fix would involve executing a major risky spacewalk that had never been envisioned nor practiced. But as a great leader would do, Pam had prepared herself and her crew to expect the unexpected. It was exactly the kind of scenario where the leader of the team has to dig deep inside, find inner strength in the face of adversity, and keep cool-headed on everyone's behalf. Both Peggy and Pam later told me that this was by far the greatest spaceflight challenge that either had faced, but the results speak for themselves. Through careful planning and risk management by the entire crew, the spacewalk was successful and the solar panel was secured. And I'm here to tell you that Pam's leadership qualities, from everything I've heard from crewmates, was certainly a cornerstone upon which that success stood. You know, there's a little grace note, by the way, to add to the 120 mission. Apparently, after the shuttle had arrived, Pam had brought Peggy a gift, a little ring with the word Harmony engraved on it that Peggy could wear on a chain around her neck. So Harmony was the name of the module, as you all heard today, that was brought up to the ISS in the payload bay of STS-120, Pam's mission. And then to Peggy's surprise, every shuttle commander who came up to the ISS from the rest of Peggy's tenure would bring an engraved charm to add to Peggy's necklace around her neck, bearing the names also of the modules that they brought. Peggy does thank Steve Prick and Dom Gorey for their thoughtfulness, but she's pretty sure she knows who came up with the idea and then ensured that the follow-on commanders carried it through. And that's a great example of Pam right there and her thoughtfulness and caring for people. Although she's always adored her work, it obviously hasn't been all work for Pam. She loves music and good fun, and she's a terrific cook. I also hear she's a big dancer and that there's some footage somewhere that proves that, but I haven't been able to find that footage yet, Pam. Just send it to me when you pull it off your computer. By the way, she has a lot of nicknames, like Pambo and Tank Girl and the Napster, which I think that last one was earned because she was famous for taking naps in the oddest places, including the C3 console of the space shuttle. Apparently, one of her favorite hangouts is a place called the Mucky Duck in Houston. And she went there on a first date with a guy named Doug Hollett. Apparently, it was a very successful date and a successful venue. For within the year, they went back there to the Mucky Duck where he asked her to be his wife. And for about 15 years now, the two of them have shared love and laughter and are generous with their friendship, as so many of you know. Spend some time with them, and you might get to taste some of Pam's cooking, or maybe samples from their amazing Australian wine collection. I asked Pam about her post-astronaut career, in particular what had drawn her to Washington, D.C. I did kind of expect to hear something about broadening into the commercial space world or the military space business to apply her skills to help the government, but instead she said, "Susan, it was very simple. The NASA Constellation program had just been canceled by the administration. I didn't understand the decision, and I just wanted to know who were all these crazy people that made that decision." So I went to Washington, D.C. to find out. Well, so much the better for all of us, because look where she is now, a top leader of NASA itself, during some of the most exciting times in NASA's history. I know her life is crazy busy, but even so, during what little free time she now has, she still perpetually makes time to be with people and to mentor the next generation, because she knows it's always going to be the people who make the future happen. Finally, I have a special message for her parents, who couldn't be here today, but are watching this ceremony on television right now at home. Dave and Helen, your daughter makes life better wherever she goes. People want to work for her and with her. Young people are inspired by her. Peers want to share good times with her and be on her team. She's the whole package, and her impact on human spaceflight, national security space, international partnerships, commercial space policy, and now a guiding hand for NASA right at this inflection point for the agency. All of this together makes clear that she's an amazing choice for the Astronaut Hall of Fame. So on behalf of all of us, thank you for producing such a daughter. Thank you. Okay, Pam, here we go.
Thank you so much. Thank you. That was amazing. So. You know, I have to say that I have been a little bit nervous. I really hate having, like, sitting and having somebody talk about me, but you know what? That was awesome. This has been a pretty amazing year for me. I am very honored to be the Deputy to Administrator Bill Nelson, and together with our Associate Administrator Bob Cabana, we are humbled and excited to lead NASA into the future. This is not a job that can be done without the support of family and friends, and I am so grateful for their presence here today. My parents, who could not be here today, but as Susan pointed out, always told me I could do anything I wanted to. It's really important to know that your kids are listening, and when you say things like that, they believe you. They have been a constant source of support for me, and most especially, I thank my husband, Doug, for his unwavering support and love. I thank the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation for this great honor to be inducted into the Astronaut Hall of Fame together with my distinguished colleagues. It's really fitting that we're gathered here in the very shadow of the space shuttle Atlantis, which I flew on my second flight, to reflect on the accomplishments of Mike, Scott, and myself, because they're inextricably linked to this vehicle that we flew. Being here in Florida always brings back floods of memories. The space shuttle was a truly unique and capable vehicle, and NASA reinvented how we used it multiple times over its 30-year history. We all have so many stories, variously nerve-wracking, thrilling, and humorous, and sometimes all three at once. Building the International Space Station was an essential part of all three of our histories. I wish we could share with you how exciting it was to see the ISS and dock to it. It looks like a piece of modern art hanging suspended for us to admire. And then we could admire the differences as we undocked, knowing that our crew had played a successful part in this grand enterprise. And as significant as the technical achievement, NASA has established deep and binding partnerships with other countries around the world. And we are maintaining and now growing those partnerships as we continue to explore. In the decades since the space shuttle's retirement, we have seen explosive growth in commercial space capability, nurtured by government-developed technology and by NASA's sponsorship and partnership. Some have asked if there is an existential threat to NASA somewhere in there. Well, I see it very differently. We have always had four pillars as the reason why we send humans to space. We do it for scientific research, for national leadership in technology, for excellent jobs in a high-growth industry, and of course, the fourth pillar, for inspiration. And none of that has changed. In fact, we have more choices now about how to accomplish those goals as we have an increasingly capable and sophisticated industry. NASA has been the engine for commercial space capability, and our fuel for that engine is exploration. So we're poised to return to the moon. We are truly at an inflection point. The mighty monster rocket with the first crew vehicle capable of sustaining humans in deep space and returning them to Earth since Apollo waits not far from here. We hope to light that candle and celebrate the launch of Artemis 1 in just a few months. However, instead of the single paramount objective of sending humans there and returning them safely to Earth that defined Apollo, we are building a program to achieve a series of objectives that will provide the blueprint to how we maintain a human presence as we explore the solar system and then the universe. Yes, of course, like Apollo, we must demonstrate the capability to keep humans alive, transport them to and from their destination. But we must also learn how to develop infrastructure, communications, positioning, navigation, and timing, power, landing sites, and even the ability to extract rocket fuel from in-situ resources. And despite the great scientific riches we gained by bringing moon rocks back to the Earth from Apollo, we can do so much more now. We have to develop capabilities to do far more science with humans on the surface of another planet. This is a major paradigm shift. And each step of the Artemis program is going to take us on this journey to prepare us for the next major destination, Mars. Even today, the Perseverance rover is taking samples in the place on Mars most likely to have hosted life in the past, the Jezero crater. And together with our European partners, those samples will be returned to the Earth in the early 2030s, guiding and supporting us to direct human exploration to the places of maximum impact when we go. Not only do we have the opportunity to find stunning insights by potentially comparing biology developed on another planet to our own biology, we can also gain insights into how a once water-covered planet is now cold and barren, and perhaps how to protect our own Earth from the same fate. Because in the end, those of us who have had the incredible good fortune to go to space know that all of humanity is the crew of Spaceship Earth, and it's our duty to care for each other and for our spaceship. And I personally am completely committed to do everything I can for you, my crew members, when you are both on and off the planet. Thank you.
Congratulations, Pam Melroy. And now it's time to introduce our third and final candidate for induction into the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame, Scott Kelly.
The 3, 2, 1. We have booster ignition and liftoff of this space shuttle Discovery on our mission to prepare the Hubble Space Telescope as we venture into the 21st century.
Discovery Houston, from the Orbit One team, Linda and I and the rest of the room would like to congratulate you for a spectacular day, making the hardest things look easy.
This lighting's pretty good here.
This is easier in space.
Goodbye, U.S. segment of the space station. We shall meet again.
Scott Kelly is a retired American astronaut and United States Navy captain, U.S. spaceflight record holder, and an experienced test pilot who has logged more than 15,000 hours of flight time in more than 40 different aircraft and spacecraft. A former fighter pilot, he flew the F-14 Tomcat aboard the aircraft carrier USS Dwight D. Eisenhower. Kelly was selected by NASA as an astronaut in 1996 a veteran of four space shuttle flights. He piloted Space Shuttle Discovery to the Hubble Space Telescope in 1999 and commanded Space Shuttle Endeavour on a mission to the International Space Station in 2007. He also took two flights on the Russian Soyuz spacecraft, launching and landing from Kazakhstan. Kelly has commanded two extended stays aboard the International Space Station. In 2010 and 2011, he spent 159 days in space. He went on to more than double that number in 2015 and 2016, when he spent a record-breaking 340 days living aboard the ISS. He also took three spacewalks during what came to be known worldwide as the year in space. Kelly has traveled more than 200 million miles, which is more than twice the distance to the sun, and has orbited the Earth more than 8,300 times. He has received many awards and honors, including the Defense Superior Service Medal, the Legion of Merit, and Distinguished Flying Cross. He was on the cover of Time magazine in December of 2014 and was named one of the 100 most influential people in 2015. And he was recognized at the 2015 State of the Union Address by President Barack Obama. He was appointed champion for space by the United Nations Office for Outer Space Affairs. He is a fellow of the Society of Experimental Test Pilots and a member of the Association of Space Explorers. Kelly is also a sought-after public speaker and author of two New York Times bestsellers. His memoir, Endurance, as well as Infinite Wonder, a collection of images he photographed aboard the ISS. He has also authored two children's picture books in the hopes of inspiring young readers to dream big. Please welcome Scott Kelly. To present Scott Kelly for induction is Hall of Fame astronaut, former KSC Center Director, and current Associate Administrator for NASA, Robert Cabana.
Well, first off, I gotta say it's really nice to come home to Florida and the Kennedy Space Center, but I want you to know how much I thoroughly enjoy serving our administrator, Bill Nelson, along with Pam, as we take NASA into the future. This is truly an amazing time for America's space program. Also, my sincere congratulations to LA and Pam, most well-deserved. Great to have you here. Scott, thank you. It's a real honor for you asking me to introduce you today and induct you into the Hall of Fame. Scott is an accomplished naval aviator, fighter pilot, test pilot, and from those videos and that timeline, you've seen what an amazing career he has had as an astronaut. I mean, he's covered the gambit of space missions that you can have. He's had a Hubble servicing mission, commanded the shuttle on an ISS assembly mission, long-duration space flights on ISS, serving as commander, totaling 520 days in space, an amazing career. What wasn't mentioned there, he also served as NASA's director of operations in Russia, working closely with our Russian partners and taking care of our astronauts that were over there training, looking after their health and welfare in Star City. But what I'm sure Scott is going to be most remembered for is the year that he spent in space aboard the ISS, advancing our knowledge of the human system in a microgravity environment, preparing for expanding our presence in the universe beyond our home planet. As chief of the astronaut office, I had the privilege of sitting on the astronaut selection board that chose Scott to be an astronaut. Now, Jim Weatherby was on that board with me, and And Scott and his brother Mark truly are identical twins. And they'd made it through all the wickets to get to be the most highly qualified. And we were going through that list of most highly qualified to see who we would invite down to Houston for an interview. And Jim and I joked that, hey, you know, we should interview one and then select the other. But, you know, we couldn't decide which one. So we interviewed them both, and we chose both of them. And I think when you look at the careers that they both had at NASA and afterwards, you're going to have to agree that we chose wisely. I must admit, while they were in the office, it was very difficult to tell them apart, unless they were wearing their blue suits with their name tags on them. And I know they had some fun with it. You can just ask their class leader, Pat Forster, about changing clothes midday and other things. I had a pretty good track record of telling you guys apart. And I heard from somebody that they thought I was keying off their watches, that I was telling them differently by their watches. So one day we were at the astronaut gym. I'm told they swapped watches to see if they could stump me, but it didn't work. Now, what I will say is, if you look closely, when the senator smiles, the left side of his mouth curls up just a little bit higher than Scott's, and that was my tell. Fortunately, Scott was kind enough to shave off his mustache in the office, and then we could always remember, oh, mustache Mark, okay, so the other one must be Scott. For those of you that don't know, Scott's call sign is Grumpy. I mean, go figure. But he doesn't like people to know that that's his call sign. It makes him grumpy. Scott is by far one of the lowest maintenance crew members that we've ever had on ISS. He's very understated and extremely competent. He gets the job done professionally and well, with no fluff or extra work from the ground, doing whatever is asked of him with no fanfare. And that comes from someone who would know, his CAPCOM, Pat Forrester, who worked with numerous crews aboard the ISS. During his year in space, he worked on one of Kennedy's plant biology experiments growing zinnias in the veggie plant growth system. A little over a month into the experiment, the zinnias weren't looking too good. And he called down to the ground and he said, you know, I think if we're going to Mars and we're growing stuff, we should be responsible for deciding when they need water. It's kind of like my backyard. I look outside and I say, hey, the grass needs to be watered. I think that's how we ought to do it. Well, the veggie team here at KSC created what was known as the Zinnia Care Guide for the On-Orbit Gardener. And it gave basic guidelines for the care and feeding of these plants, putting all the judgment on Scott to make the right decisions. So rather than pages and pages of complex procedures to follow like NASA does for experiments, you know, this was a one-page streamlined resource to support Scott as an autonomous gardener. Soon, the flowers were flourishing, and a couple months later, Scott had a full bouquet of zinnias for Valentine's Day. Now, while that may not be one of the most advanced scientific discoveries during Scott's trip in space, it says a lot about his character. He is committed to the success of the team. He sees a challenge and thinks not only about today's impacts, but the bigger picture. How is this going to impact us down the road? He makes a plan and he gets it done. If you talk with those who flew with him, you'll find out that he was a great mentor to all of them, offering direct, actionable advice that many praised after their missions with Scott. To be selected into the Astronaut Hall of Fame requires more than just flying in space. how the person contributed to the U.S. space program, the advancement of spaceflight, our knowledge of the universe, how to improve the quality of life here on Earth, are all factors that are to be considered. Scott excelled in all those areas. As part of the team that serviced Hubble, he contributed to expanding our knowledge of the universe. For his more than year in space on ISS, he advanced our knowledge of the long-term effects of microgravity on the human body, paving our way for that next giant leap to Mars. And many of the over 400 experiments that he participated in and conducted while he was up there are helping to improve the quality of life right here on Earth. Scott continued to excel after NASA as the United Nations champion for space, an accomplished author, and a gifted speaker, sharing his experiences, inspiring the next generation, and supporting the peaceful use of space for the benefit of all humankind. Scott is a true professional, and it is my extreme honor and privilege to welcome him into the Astronaut Hall of Fame. Scott, congratulations.
Thank you, Colonel Cabana. It's kind of weird that I refer to Bob Cabana as Colonel Cabana because, I'm also a retired Navy 06, and he's a retired 06 in the Marine Corps. But when I went into the astronaut office, he was a colonel and I was lieutenant. So it was my habit to always refer to him as Colonel Cabana, and habits are sometimes hard to break. Now I'm old and he's still old. So thank you for the honor. And I also want to recognize my two fellow inductees, L.A. and Pam. I couldn't be more proud to be in a group with them. So it's really odd for me to be standing here today and talking to all of you being in the Hall of Fame, being inducted into the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame. Because when I was a kid, I wasn't too sure I would accomplish much of anything. I was not a good student like probably most of the people in this room that are former or maybe current astronauts, if there's any in here. I was a kid that sat in the back of the classroom looking out the window or, looking at the clock just trying to make it go faster. And even though I was interested in space, because I was a, child of the 1960s and I remember the Apollo missions and Neil Armstrong and Buzz landing on the moon and going there with Mike Collins, it's not something I ever thought I could possibly do. I was interested in space and dinosaurs, and I figured I could be neither. So go figure how that happened, right? But I'm going to tell you how it happened, and it has to do with other people and the help and inspiration you get along the way on this journey we call life. And for me, it started with my parents. My dad was a cop in New Jersey, 1960s and 70s. He was, one of these stereotypical Irish cop guys. He'd come home once a year with a, cast on his hand, and he'd tell my brother Mark and I about how he broke his fist fighting crime. Years later, we learned that there was a lot more bar fighting going on than crime fighting. And her mom was a secretary and a waitress. Growing up, had a bunch of different jobs, and about the time my brother and I were becoming teenagers, she decided that she wanted to be a police officer like my dad. And this was a time in New Jersey, there were very few female police officers, none in our hometown, and she had to do all the same tests that were designed for the men, including scaling this like 7-foot, 4-inch tall wall that my dad built in our backyard. He actually built it an inch taller without even telling her. It's actually a good idea. And, I remember the first time in the summer that she tried to get over that wall and she fell off into the dirt. But I remember picking herself up, brushing herself off, and saying, to my brother and I can't get over this wall now, but I'm going to just try to touch the top. And as soon as I can do that, I'm going to see how long I can hold on for. You know, maybe if I never give up, I'll be able to get over this wall someday. And she worked really, really hard that whole summer. She had to do another test, was dragging a dummy 100 feet. And at the time, 130-pound dummy, and at the time, I just happened to weigh 130 pounds. Not anymore. You know, so with my help, a little bit from my brother, when she went to take that test, she got over that wall in half the time she was supposed to, did better than a lot of the men did, and became the first female police officer in my hometown of West Orange, New Jersey. And very proud of her and for the inspiration she provided Mark and I. Now, unfortunately, that did not help me become a better student. You know, I was still very much distracted, couldn't pay attention. Went to college because, you know, it was the thing I was supposed to do. Struggled there until one day I was just happened to walk across the college campus and went into the bookstore to buy, I don't know, gum or something, not a book. Not a big reader. But I saw this book on the shelf. Had this really cool title, red, white, and blue cover. Made me pick it up. I looked at the back and read it. And took my gum money, was interested enough. Purchased the book, went back to my dorm room and laid there for the next few days on my unmade dorm room bed. Reading the stories of the fighter pilots that became the test pilots that became the original Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo astronauts. And the book was The Right Stuff by Tom Wolfe. And I don't know if it was Tom's, you know, creative writing style or, you know, maybe, you know, just how he told stories, but I recognized, you know, traits that these guys had that I felt like I had in myself, with one exception, and that is I was a bad student. But I thought, you know, if I could fix that one thing about myself, you know, maybe I can go on and, you know, graduate from college someday with an engineering degree, you know, maybe go into the Navy and fly airplanes. Maybe if not the Navy, maybe the Air Force, right? It's easier, right, Kurt? You know, maybe quite possibly even a test pilot someday. And I know you know might think, you know, 18-year-old kid reads book, decides he or she's going to become an astronaut. That's a giant leap. But really, in retrospect, for me, what it was a bunch of much more smaller, manageable steps supported all the way by other people. And a lot of those people are in this room today. You know, particularly the people, you know, I flew in space with. I learned something from every single one of the 40 people I have had the privilege and pleasure to fly in space with. And like I said, including some people in this room, like John Grunsfeld right here. You know, before I flew in space with him, I had no idea what the origins of the universe was, where it came from. We were just talking about that again. He updated me in the back. He wasn't so sure. He was sure then. Now his theory has changed a little bit. Of course, Kurt, I was the pilot on Kurt's last mission. It was my first as the pilot, and I couldn't have learned from a better space shuttle commander than Kurt how to fly the space shuttle, so much so that I only had the privilege of doing it once and was assigned for my second flight as the commander, which some of these people in the room, I think Rommel was part of that, certainly Steve Lindsay. So I thank you for having that trust in me to be able to do that with very little training. And I also had the privilege of flying in space with Steve when I was on my first long duration flight. And I wanna thank Steve, because I think if it wasn't for him, I probably wouldn't be standing here, because I can remember I was having lunch or dinner with my sister-in-law Gabby in DC, just her and I. And Steve calls me and tells me he wanted me to fly a long duration space flight. And I think what I said to you was no, not interested. I want to fly this. I'm a shuttle commander, I thought. I need to fly another shuttle mission. And he said, well, okay, call me back tomorrow. Think about it. And I did. I called him back. And, you know, my whole philosophy has always been, if someone asks you to do something hard and you want to find a way out, that's fine. But when they come back to you the second time, if it's good for the team, then that's what you need to do. Who else have I flown in space here with? Dave Williams is here somewhere. Dave was one of my crew members on our second mission. I think it was his second flight as well. And I don't know how many of you know Dave, but Dave is, barely has a pulse. when anything is going wrong, just look at Dave and just try to be as calm as him. That's what I learned from Dave. You know, of course, Janet Cavandi, at one point in my astronaut career, she was interviewing me to be the chief of the astronaut office. And at the end of the interview, the last question she asked me is, she goes, Scott, if you'd rather be, would you rather be chief of the astronaut office or fly for a year in space? And I said, Janet, absolutely, I'd rather be the chief of the astronaut office. And like a week later, she gave that job to somebody else, and then now I'm standing here today. So thank you for not listening to me, Janet. Appreciate that. And of course, you know, my wife, Amiko, who's standing here, is with us here today. People may not be aware of this, but I was assigned to that mission, and then the very next day I was told I was unassigned for a medical reason. And I went home, and I told, after being all excited about it, eventually I came to terms with this idea of, you know, flying a year-long mission, and I really wanted to do it. And then I was disqualified. And I came home, and I said, well, okay, not flying in space. And she goes, okay, but why are you just taking that, you know, sitting down? Why don't you make the argument about why you're the right person to do this? So, you know, with her encouragement, I stayed up all night, made a good case for, you know, what medical issue I was dealing with, and quickly that was turned around. So I want to thank her for that and all the support she's given me. And, of course, my brother Mark, he's not here. He'll be here tonight. You know, there's many stories I could tell about him encouraging me along the way, and I just want to thank him for being that lifelong wingman to me. And, of course, the public. You know, without the public support for our space program and their interest in it, we wouldn't have these extraordinary opportunities. And, you know, my professional life at NASA has really been the highlight of my life, so I really feel a need to really genuinely thank the American public for supporting this space program. And of course, you know, lastly, you know, what I've learned in my career and life is that, you know, making giant leaps requires small, manageable steps and the help of a lot of people along the way, including many in this room. Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Scott. Now I have one question. How do we really know it's you?
Yeah, Mark doesn't have a mustache anymore.
Yeah. This is tough.
Yeah.
We've got to take
you. Got a better suit than I
do. He's got a better suit than you do. Okay. Now I'd like to ask Michael and Pam to join us on the stage again. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the 19th class of the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame, Michael López-Alegría, Pam Melroy, and Scott Kelly. As you may know, each inductee into the U.S. Don't go anywhere, Scott. Into the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame is immortalized with a likeness that will soon be housed in Heroes and Legends, featuring the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame presented by Boeing. It is my honor, now you guys can go over there, to unveil those displays to you today. Inductees, please take your places. Once again, it is my pleasure. Huh? You taking selfies now? Unbelievable. You going to do that back up in space? Once again, it is my pleasure to present to you Michael López-Alegría, Pam Melroy, and Scott Kelly, your 2020 United States Hall of Fame astronauts. Would all members of the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame please join us on the stage for a photo